Hi, I'm Randall Wedge.
How are things going, Randall?
Oh, good. Going very well. Very well.
Tell us about the play.
This play is The Lady of Shalott. It's in medieval times, around 5th, 6th century. We tried to be as true to costuming as possible. There's a lot of choreography involved in this play.
And why did you decide to do this?
Well, Tony Hamilton Irving approached me to do this production, and one of the reasons why I did want to do it was because of the amount of choreography in it, because being a dancer myself, I thought it was a very interesting project.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I guess we have lots of people to meet here.
Sure.
So where did those pile of people go that were standing there?
Well, the crew are very unphotogenic. They like to hide, so they're all preparing for the show. So this is Jody. Jody?
Okay.
Wave, Jody. She's their stage manager. She's my right hand. She's the boss.
Okay.
That's Jody, and then most of the other people.
Most of the crew,
they're over here. Over here, we have,
let's
walk this way. First of all, that's Sparky, Chris Copeland, there with the fan.
And he's got a fan, good.
Yeah. And this is Bruce Collard, he's the flyman.
Howdy.
And this is George Wedge, he's our other flyman, flyman number two.
Special effects.
Where's the other crew? Is Bob up at his spot? Over here we have two more stage crew, Ainsley and Whitney.
Where are they?
Kendrick, right here. Wave, Whitney! Wave, Ainsley! And Susan is the assistant stage manager. She's holding the dagger and the white sweater.
Okay.
That's Susan. Now, I don't know where Spot Bob's at. He's probably up.
Hey, Bob, you ready?
Bob's not there. Here's the Hamilton Irving.
Hi, Tony. How are you?
Very well. How are you?
Great.
Tony, it's a video, right?
It's video?
You can talk.
Yeah, I know that. I just write. I don't talk.
Okay. Here. Okay.
What's your job in the play?
Hi, I'm Whitney, and I'm a backstage person.
Thanks. Right. What do you do?
I move props during the scene changes.
Okay, and who do we have here?
Hi, I'm Susan. I'm assistant stage manager. And that is supervising this. I'm Christopher.
Thank you. And down here?
I'm Christopher. I lead.
What's that dagger for?
For stabbing people.
Oh, nice to meet you. I'll be nice to you. And who do we have here?
I'm Greg. I'm a warrior and a ballroom dancer.
Okay. Greg, are you acting for a while?
I've been acting for off and on community projects at school and that's about a year and a half now.
And what's this show like?
This show has actually been great. It was a really good experience, definitely for a dance opportunity. It's been real fun.
Okay, thank you.
I'm Jeremy. I'm a soldier in the battle scene and the market scene and the ballroom.
Mm-hmm. And is this your first acting job?
Yeah.
How is it?
Yeah, it's good. I like it. Yeah. A lot of fun.
Thank you. And hi, what's your name?
Josh.
And what are you doing, Josh?
Page in the first.
What page are you?
I'm a page in the first battle scene and the second two scenes of my life.
Okay.
And I'm in the market and ballroom.
Okay, have a good show tonight. And over here, Doc. What's your name?
I'm Emily Key.
And what are you doing tonight?
I'm a dancer.
Dancing? What kind?
I guess you could say modern day dance.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and I'm a witch.
Well, we knew that, but I'm saying, what are you in this show? Just kidding. Have a good show tonight. Yeah. And over here, who do we have?
John.
And John? Is this...
This is a real injury, not...
Real injury, not part of the show. What happened?
I was walking down to McDonald's and walking on a concrete sidewalk and fell off. Horse around with my friends.
So what were you supposed to be doing here?
I was playing a soldier and now I play a soldier.
Wounded.
Yeah, wounded soldier. The town drunk and I play a piano player.
Okay. Thank you. And over here.
Yes.
How are you?
Good.
Nice to see you here.
Yeah.
And say your name and what you're doing tonight.
Okay, I'm Mafiola today, and I'm the fairy.
The fairy?
Yeah.
The good fairy.
The good fairy.
As opposed to...
No, as opposed to the sorceress, Jessica.
Hi, Jessica. How are you?
Good.
And you're the sorceress?
Yeah.
What do you do for that part?
Well, I go around putting spells on everybody, I guess.
Mm-hmm. And what's this play like for you?
It's fun. It's really fun.
Great. Okay. Haven't seen you for a while. You already introduced yourself.
Are you recording?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, my God.
And who do we have here?
Sarah Remley.
Hi, Sarah. What part are you playing tonight?
I'm the handmaiden and a witch. I dance.
Okay. Well, have a good night.
Thanks.
And did I talk to these two? Not yet. Hi.
Hi.
Go ahead and say your name.
I'm May. And I play the Lady of Shabbat.
That sounds
Everybody clap.
That sounds like the starring role, right?
Isn't yeah, I guess it would be.
It is. What's this like for you in this particular show?
It's a real challenge to be in. It demands a lot of yourself getting into the role and trying to fulfill that character as well as you can.
Yeah. Well, have a good show. And over here?
Hi, I'm Shirley. I play Blaze, and I also play a witch. I'm dancing for my first time on stage. This is really exciting to me.
Yeah. So, do you know most of these people?
A lot of them are some of the dancers. I didn't know before, but a lot of them also community theater, you normally have the same people coming back, so.
Okay, thanks.
Yeah, thank you.
Hi.
Hi, my name is Rosalind. And I play two walk-on parts. I walk on as Queen Guinevere, and I also walk on in the ballroom scene as a countess. And I'm the understudy for Malleus. That's the highlight of my life.
Wow.
I don't push her off the stage
or something?
Oh, I've done everything, but it hasn't worked. I did a couple of matinees, and I did an evening show, so I'm very happy. It's the highlight of my life. It's great, great fun. Didn't know any of these people before.
Okay.
Hi, I'm Bob Baker.
Hi, Bob.
I'm Surtee, leader of the Saxon army. Mm-hmm. And they all are just treat me terrible, and they stab me, and they wound me, and do the whole thing.
Is that just before the show starts, or during the show?
Probably after the show starts, I would like to do it again. I'm here because I tried it one other time, met tremendous people, and I'm doing the same thing on this show.
Okay, well, thanks very much.
You're most welcome.
I support you 100%. Okay. You want to support
her? She pays me alimony.
She's what?
Like, she's also the understudy for the sorceress.
She's stealing the show. Yes,
you have to keep the warm up.
Okay.
Hi there.
Hi.
I'm Ray Como.
Hi, Ray.
Hi there.
You're a familiar face on TV.
Yes, I've been here for a few years, and I'm in three parts. At the beginning, I play a dead soldier, and then I'm on two walk-on scenes, like in the ballroom scene and the market scene. And it's a great, great bunch of people to work with. And Randy's a great guy, and Tony, and Jody.
Okay.
They're all great to work with.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Anybody else?
Hi, how are you doing?
Good.
And doing a bit of stretching here, warm up.
And what's your name?
Oh, my name is Pascal, and I'm gonna play a soldier part. I'm a member of the soldier in the Loyal Army. And I'm also a member of the backstage crew now.
And what are you doing? Just the warm-ups now?
Just a bit of stretching and arm practice here.
Okay, well, have a good show.
Thanks a lot.
Oh, I could tell.
Short,
I could tell.
Maybe I have a bit of that Arnold Schwarzenegger accent. Yeah, I'm from Germany. I'm an exchange student here, and I'm staying till July. I'm staying at the Moyes family here in Summerside. And I hope we're gonna have a great show this evening.
Great. And what's your name?
I'm Jody Walton. I'm the stage manager.
And what's this show been like for you, Jody?
Oh, pretty chaotic. Really busy. Really busy training all new crew, basically, and working with a fairly large cast.
How many people in the cast?
27. 27 cast members, a lot of them fairly new to theater, and some of them doing dance for the first time in their lives.
Do not touch?
Do not touch means don't bother me while I'm busy or I'm just going to scream at people. It's just a little joke. Bye-bye.
And you haven't got her yet.
Yes, you have.
Yeah. Haven't interviewed her, have you?
My name's Ainsley Kendrick.
And what do you do doing with tonight?
I'm working backstage.
I love to see you.
Okay, there you go.
Looks good.
I'm working backstage and moving stuff.
Okay, have a good show tonight.
You know what's bad, eh? When I go to a restaurant, they say, hey, you're getting that plate, eh? Have you seen it? No, well, I know someone that can do soup. You're great. Well, as long as they work 60 hours a week, right?
Oh, hi! Greetings, my lord.
And what's your name? You're obviously in the play.
Actually, no, I'm not.
Oh, okay.
I'm with the head costumer, and I was her assistant in preparing the costumes for this performance.
So you decided to...
We decided to come over and see the show. And so I'm here wearing one of our costumes to show what can be accomplished.
That's beautiful.
Why, thank you, my lord. It is hand-dyed, mostly sewn by hand, and quite representative of the 14th century. You would have seen variations of this bit earlier as well.
No.
Those were...
Thank you.
You're welcome, my lord.
I'm going to go get changed.
You'll never change.
How you doing?
Who does that represent?
That's your Aetherians. That's the side that I fight for. That's my character.
Good chainmail gloves.
What did you say?
Good chainmail gloves, yes.
Chainmail. Not really chainmail.
From a distance, all is possible.
Good luck. Just call me the... Model of the medieval ages. Strike pose.
Thanks.
Yeah, you got to just
say it. Okay, I have some
gouges.
I'm getting pretty gouged,
isn't it?
That axe is taking...
It's the axe. Yeah. This is aluminum. Start getting the steel in the way.
Yeah.
sprayed my hair.
It's not working out.
Can we set these down too?
Ooh, thanks.
Ooh, red light.
Hi, cameraman.
Hi. Look in the mirror.
Are you serious?
Smile. Thank you. Look in the mirror. Give me a smile. Look in the mirror. And give me a smile in the mirror.
How'd you do what he says?
Did you hear that?
She's still not looking in the mirror at the camera. There.
Yeah, I'm sure.
Tonight?
Yeah, she's gonna be here.
She's coming tonight.
So say hi, Mom.
No, she's ushering. Hi, Mom. No, she's ushering tonight. Let me show you my big mess.
Just a second, I gotta go get some spice.
You almost caught me. My shirt just barely got on.
Great time for her to put her clothes back on just when he's coming in with the camera.
Yeah, I got you guys stabbing each other.
Kill my daddy.
Why did you have to put your shirt on? Come in.
Wait, my pants are off!
Yeah, we got a camera in here too.
This is my sword. No one's taking my sword, or I'll open a big can of whoop ass on them.
I
you can tell that?
Whoop ass.
What? I'm just joking with you. I'm just kidding with you. I'm kidding with me. I was just performing for the camera.
You can get a problem with the
Thank you.
They shall be slain! Ah! Wild dogs know no master, but ye shall soon know their vengeance! Ah!
Kill Texas!
Go, knights of the Royal Army, I command the only victor! Ah! Yes, too, is an educational journey! Ah! 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 Any lessons you've learned will be practiced in the dens of hell! Ah!
Ah! We present this colors to eternity's keeping in the name of King and Country!
In the name of King and Country!
Slay the fleeing Saxons! Justice in the name of King Arthur has been served upon steel to all treasonous Saxons! Is it not sweet justice that your serving should be left to my hand, Serdic? None, including yourself, could ever deny your treasonous ways. The justice and punishment I am about to exact upon you, I offer in the memory of every Arthurian subject who has been felled by your Saxon serpentine steel.
You are God's grandest fool if you truly believe that the steel of your words or weapons could silence forever the destiny of the superior Saxon race. For not even my death will bring you peace, for from my death will rise your life's greatest fear. Beware the maiden's hands, Arthurian fool! Beware the maiden's hands!
It is for Camelot! It is in the name of King Arthur!
Has our child found the rest she sought?
She had been sent upon a journey of dreams some time ago. I shall go and assess her level of comfort.
In the annals of the tides of man, Sir Lancelot, our most recent victory and ensuing subjugation are a wave that will hereafter be given its due consideration and praise.
Ah, what you say is true, good Bedivere. The king's royal poet Rhetoric has already begun the writings that will bring our army's most glorious moments towards the praise of all future generations. Arthur himself has spoken of your courageous deeds with his strongest and truest voice. And no doubt you've heard Merlin's most glowing predication of Camelot's future, and indeed of your own. Wasn't it he who first spoke of the blessing that you and your Malleus were to receive? Could any man come home from battle to a greater reward than a child's arrival? Ah, your beautiful daughter is truly a blessing from God, my friend. A reward for your service to both God and country.
The treasonous Saxons are now only tainted memories beneath the soil of our lands, or the ashes of judicious pyres that have long ago ceased to burn. Our victory was one of great measure, Lancelot, for tremors born of the might of King Arthur and his armies have been felt from France to the Red Sea. My brother has brought peace unto lands that once knew only the ways of savages. They should be on their knees in praise for his mercy and his deliverance of their souls from the devil's hands. I thank God each day for granting me the right to take with my sword the last breath from Cerdic's soul. Praise God upon high. Praise good King Arthur.
Praise to God and to our king.
The world that my daughter and my other future heirs will inherit is one far better than we have known. The wars and pestilence we have survived will not darken their skies, nor will the uncertainty of our youth be theirs. For with both our weaponry and the words of our king, we have ensured future peace and prosperity for our children and the children of loyal Arthurian subjects throughout the lands. Allow me to tend to your thirst, Sir Lancelot.
Has my beautiful daughter found the sleep that her tired body and soul had sought? The doves of peace outside her window have been singing such beautiful songs. Surely they have carried her aloft to a world of only gentle trance. Dear God in heaven,
Malleus, what say you of our child, my heir? There must be a reasonable explanation of her whereabouts forthcoming. Summon those who serve her at once.
Is this to do with the answer you seek?
You were a fool's fool, Bedivere. Did not I tell you? Beware the maiden's hand. The maiden's hand.
Sir Lancelot! Prepare the knights and my armies to ride. I swear to God that before the sun shall rise again, my daughter will be returned, and her abductors will know the wrath of my royal steel.
Thank you.
pricked Bedivere slain, just as you commanded, father. I now only ask you to leave Sir Lancelot to me.
And orated on many a happy and auspicious occasions, poet, does a somber moment such as the one at hand both cloud moments and memories once clear in the tribute that you're endeavoring to bring forth?
It is so, Sir Lancelot. Yet, all tears of sorrow flow with tears of joy when one thinks of what dear Bedivere has done for kin and country. Upon the Spanish plains, he fought with the ferocity of a cornered lion, lashing out against the tyranny of the Saxon race. They came at him, and he displayed the might of his sword. A boy, no more than 12, who witnessed Bedivere's final defiance stand, tall King Arthur himself. No less than a score of devil's hounds set out upon him. He mortally wounded a dozen or more, and sent all but one running cowardly to the hills. He would have sent the last of the devil's guardsmen straight to hell had it not been for exhaustion born of the fight. Even after the devil's sword pierced his heart, he brought from the very depths of his soul his dying pronouncement, crying out for all upon God's earth to hear. In the Lord's name, love shall lead my daughter home.
While so much said, despite saying nothing at all of those whose faith had been spared by his bravery, what if I and the other knights of the Round Table, would we have ever again met as one if not for his sacrifice? For 15 years and more he crossed foreign lands and oceans in his undying effort to secure his daughter's safe return to Camelot and to Malleus. He was a legend in his lifetime, and he'll be a martyr, a saint in his passing.
You speak the Lord's truth, Sir Lancelot. You ask how Bedivere's time will be written. I must confess, my quill bleeds freely upon the page, yet I am without tools of resolution. Merlin has predicted that Bedivere's time, dying pronouncement, shall live to see its day, though we could not speak of time or place.
I shall leave such predictions to God and to those he has anointed. Yet I do wonder if there ever again could be two who could love as Malleus and Bedivere had. Could there ever again be so innocent a soul left to mourn the loss of such a love and more?
The whispering winds will one day reveal to I all secrets kept. Until that day, these words my quill bleeds shall remain unsung.
Thank you.
I bring only the blessings of God with me, and I pray the means to allay your present and future fears.
Though such words are calming in their nature, I cannot live in the absence of fear if I am not party to your reasons for coming to this island, an island that has known no other but I. For all the days and years that I can and cannot recall.
It has been my unseen servitude that has kept you safe from harm for all of the days that you have known. Have you never wondered, child, why no desire to leave this place of isolation has found its way to your heart? Have you never realized that all who could do harm to you have been kept at bay? Surely you have noticed that your weaving has been an endless obsession of both pain and pleasure? And what of this mirror that sits before you without support and offers you merely shadows of all images true?
I know not the answers to your riddles or your inquiries, yet I do know that my life has been a shrouded mystery to even me. I am a life without memory and without awareness of what or whom has brought me to this place.
The curse of Satan has placed you upon this island, child. The love of your father and of God has kept you here.
I ask you, how could such actions by God or man be considered any more noble than those of Satan's original intent? By mine eyes, the results are of equal measure.
My child, a curse was placed upon you when you came to this island, cast o'er you by the same cold heart that sentenced you to your life's isolation. I've been watching o'er you from beyond, yet urgency has overtaken my cause. Your heart has carried too much sorrow, and the time to strengthen your conviction is at hand. I cannot put to rest your fears by telling you who has brought this curse upon you, or who it is that has empowered me so. Yet I can tell you what means must be at your disposal if you are to ensure that the curse will not take its full effect.
I shall entertain your thoughts and your predictions, yet within that same moment, I will be wary of the fact that evil comes in many forms.
My thoughts and my predictions are of one truth, and I as I present them to you now. The full effect of the curse upon you will not take its course, for as long as you can avoid these two doors of the devil's invention. First, you must never leave the island of Shalott. I will keep you safe from harm for as long as you remain here. Of equal importance, you must never look directly into the faces of those who make their home within Tower Camelot. Their forms and their faces are what I have allowed you to see in shadow upon the mirror I've offered for a comfort, for no soul deserves to live in isolation.
For reasons I cannot say, I find myself taking consolation in your words, though I live in caution. For your warnings have in no measure eased my heart's burden.
I will not forsake you, my child, nor will those who seek to protect you, the Lady of Shalott.
The chains of my conviction allow my soul its peace. Will the chains of my conviction release me to the seas? Will freedom o'ertake me and satiate my need? Will the chains of my conviction allow my soul's peace?
Good morrow to you, my dear friend. I have been working on several new feats that I hope will bring the king great pleasure. If you would be my audience through their trial performance, I would be most honored. Pray? Have I lost my talent? For juggling your time, your patience, and your most insatiable curiosity? If mine efforts cannot give rise to a friend's gentle smile, how will I ever be able to please King Arthur and Guinevere? Tell me, Lancelot, has my destiny fallen so far that I will soon be presenting command performances to the swallows that rest upon the tower sill? Or worse yet, will I find myself toting sacks again for the old cook? She's often told me that if she ever had the opportunity again, she would beat the whimsy right out of me. Tell me I've not lost my way, my friend, because by now the cook has realized it was I who put the pigeons in her flour barrel, and it was I who put the spirits in her morning tea. Ah, tell me I'm still the same jocular jester. After all, was I not the only jester who did cause the bishop to titter like a young schoolgirl?
How strange that you are quite sullen. Just such a moment, I was wondering how you remained so happy all the time. Despite my good fortune and my position as King Arthur's champion, I must admit, my friend, that I'm very sad. Though I have crossed the lands from sea to sea and I've had many the attention of a lady fair, I must admit I've never known true love. Do you know of what I speak?
Well, though you may find yourself wary of a jester's confession, I must earnestly admit that I have known love in many forms. For though seen as a fool, the jester harbors within himself all the emotions of those that come before him. He exacts the love of the young and the old as they marvel at his foolish ways. Secretly, they all wish to play the part of the fool, but they are bound by the ways of age. They live through his performance. He sheds their tears. He spreads their laughter. He carries their love. The jester cannot truly fear rejection, yet at the same time, he does not feel that he's privileged enough to carry just for his love for another in his heart. Yes, I guess one could say that I am at the very least familiar with love.
Ah, your brimstone eloquence touches me, my friend. But yet it brings me no closer to understanding my one true question. Why am I so fervently bound to a path of love when at the same moment I have no knowledge of whom I'll be partaking in this journey with?
Laughter and love are not so different, my friend, for each lives and dies by the conviction of its bearer. I must leave you now, kind knight, for somewhere out there solicited laughter awaits its turn to replenish my tattered reputation.
Do not the tide or the chain usually know the reason for their sentence? I weave as I have done, to count the hours, mark the days, and mourn the fleeing years. All lives about me come forth only in shadows, and the images that I weave are in the forms of the shadows that I see. I have seen the images of processions in bliss and processions in sorrow. I have seen the shadows of lovers in search of the light of God and the magic to be found within the forest depths. I know that such simple gifts are a blessing to my peace of mind, yet I cannot deny praying that my life will bring forth pleasures of greater meaning. If I am to be imprisoned here for the remainder of my years, cannot but one humble wish be granted unto me?
Mine eyes have never before seen such a radiant creature. Your presence has become this day's greatest gift. If I could ask but for one wish, it would be to know your name.
I am but the wind and trickery in your imagination and no more.
Has God sentenced me to a life without love? Or am I just a fool in pursuit of the wind? Love has found its way into my heart, and I shall not surrender to its yearning. I shall not rest until I have offered her my hand, my heart, my life. Please come back before my mouth. My love. My Lady of Shalott. Thank you.